Jesus gave his life for ransom.
Yonder on Calvary, on Mount Calvary, that cruel Calvary, and paved the way by blood that we might wear a shining crown. Praise his blessing, holy and salvation that have been brought down. Oh, glory, praise the Lord, tell the Lord, salvation that's been brought down.
Good to see each and every one of you. Tonight's a special treat. This week we've had our second, we're in the middle of our second annual Brown Trail School of Preaching Future Preacher Camp. And so tonight, Wednesday night, the young men will be leading us during our Bible hour with some songs, prayer, and some lessons. So I encourage you to grab your Bibles and songbooks and be ready to be led by these young men. They've been doing a great job. They've been very attentive. They've been eating lots of food. So I don't know if some of the jackets are fitting or not, but no. They've been doing a great job. And the men of the Brown Trail School of Preaching and ministers from around the area that are coming out to teach during this week has been a great benefit to them. I hope that they will take away here on Friday when they depart from here, they'll take away a great wealth of knowledge and be able to share it with family, their friends, and their local congregation. So proud of them, and I know that their parents and their congregation is very proud of them too. Josh and Shane and Hayden back there, and Jose and Cam and Israel and Caleb. We have seven campers, and they've been doing a great job along with that, they've been helping out around here during their downtime to help keep things tidy. So that's good for guys, right? So, but before we get into our singing and our lessons, if you would at this time, would you bow with me in prayer? Our Father God, we love you and we thank you for the safe travels we've received to get here tonight, and it's great to be with the family of God. We pray, Father, at this hour that you watch over us. Help us, Lord, to be focused on your word and the songs of praise that we sing to you. We love you and we thank you for forgiving us of our sins, and thank you for your son, Jesus, and the sacrifice he made on the cross. Father, thank you for the hope that we have in eternity. Father, we're proud of these young men. We thank you for their love for you, and we pray that you'll give them courage and strength they need. It's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.
I think the reason John said that some of our suits weren't fitting is because he saw me up here first, and it's not fitting very well now. Our first song of praise is going to be 37. Song number 37, Angry Words. 3:7. If you have it, let's sing. Angry words,
oh, let them end.
Can you please turn to page 810? You have it, let's sing. Jesus loves me.
This I know.
Jesus, take this heart.
The Bible tells us who we are, why we are here, where we go when we leave this place. We are human beings who have been made in the image and likeness of God. Genesis chapter 1, verse 26 through 27. God formed the first man, Adam, out of the dust of the earth, and then breathed into his nostrils the breath of life. And man became a living being. Genesis 2, verse 7. Our bodies are made of beyond death. Matthew 10, verse 28. Luke 16, verse 22. After death, the spirit returned to God. Ecclesiastes chapter 12, verse 7. God created us to be Christian children in his royal family. Ephesians chapter 1, verse 5. As such, God give us to work to do for him. All things, including humans, by him, for him. Colossians 1, verse 16. God should be our greater test, love. Love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind and all your strength. Mark chapter 12, verse 30. Can you please turn there? Mark 12, verse 30. If you have it, let's read. And you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul, with all your mind and with all your strength. This is the first commandment. God gives us to each person his assigned task. Mark 12, verse 34. We give glory to God by finishing the work he gives us to do. John 17, verse 24. And so like early Christians, we should be the praise of his glory. Ephesians 1, 12. The Bible speaks only two possible places after death, when this life and time have ended. One is called heaven. 2 Corinthians 5:1. A place of joy and peace and happiness. It is where the saved life with God. John 14, verse 1 through 3. Can you please turn there? John 14, verse 1 through 3. If you have it, let's read. Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you to myself, that where I am, there you may be also. There's also a place called hell. Matthew 5:29. It's a place of pain and sorrow. All who put other above God and his will must be punished there forever. Matthew 25, verse 41. If we belong to Christ, he takes us to heaven to live with him. Our If we leave him in life, he will be our fiery home. If we endure him, he will also reign. We will also reign with him. If we deny him, he also will deny us. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 12.
Our next song of praise is going to be 888-888. Thank you, Lord. 888. If you have it, let's sing. Thank you, Lord, for loving me, and
thank you, Lord, for blessing me. Thank you, Lord.
Philippians 2, 5-8. In your mindset with one another, have the same mindset as Christ Jesus, who being in the very nature God, did not consider equality with God something to be used to his own advantage. Rather, he made himself nothing. By taking the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness, and being found in appearance as a man, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to death, even death on a cross. We're going to talk about what Jesus was willing to do and what he did for humanity. First, we see that he was equal to God, but he did not use it to his advantage. John 1:1, in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The Word being Jesus. Jesus was with God. John 1:14, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. We see that Jesus was up in his throne, in heaven, his home, his holy place. But when the Father told him to go down, he didn't use it to his advantage. He didn't use any of his power to his advantage. He came down. Hebrews 1:2, it says, whom he's appointed higher of all things, through whom also he made the world. He had a power and control over everything. But when the Father told him to come down, he didn't use any of the power. He obeyed him and came down. He left everything for us. Second, he made himself nothing. He made himself human. He became a servant. Mark 10:45. We see that it says, for even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life a ransom for many. In John 13, 12-17, he gives us the example. Please turn to me there. John 13, 12-17. It says, so when he had washed their feet, taken his garments, and sat down again, he said to them, do you know what I have done to you? You call me teacher and Lord, and you say, well, for so I am. If I then, your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you ought to wash one another's feet. For I have given you an example, that you should do as I have done for you. Most assuredly, I tell you, a servant is no greater than his master, nor is he who is sent greater than the one who sent him. If you know these things, blessed are you if you do them. We know that Jesus was in glory, in heaven, the most wonderful place to be. But he made himself nothing, the lowest of the lowest, to a point where he didn't have a place to lay his head, a place to call a home in this earth. He taught us how to serve. He helped so many people. He washed the disciples' feet. He put everyone before himself. He made himself a servant, and he wants us to follow his footsteps and serve back. Finally, number three, he became obedient to death. Luke 22, 42 to 45. He says, "Father, if you are willing, take this cup from me, yet not my will, but yours be done." An angel from heaven appeared to him, strengthened him, and being in anguish, he prayed more earnestly, and his sweats were like drops of blood falling to the ground. Christ knew what he had signed up for. He knew what was coming. He prayed to God to rethink what was about to happen, but he was obedient. Hebrews 5, 7 through 9. During the days of Jesus' life on earth, he offered up prayers and petitions with fervent cries and tears to the one who could save him from death. And he was heard because of his relevant submission. Son though he was, he learned obedience from what he suffered, and once made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation for all who obey him. Again, we see that Jesus did what was necessary, even though it meant death. He was the sour cup that saved us. In conclusion, we see that Jesus was willing to sacrifice everything for us. Romans 5, 9 through 11, "Since we have now been justified by his blood, how much more shall we be saved from God's wrath through him? For if while we were God's enemies, we were reconciled through him through the death of his son, how much more, having been reconciled, shall we be saved through his life? Not only is this so, but we also boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, whom we have now received reconciliation." What are you willing to do?
Song number 761. 761. If it is convenient, if you would be standing while we sing this song.
Sweet are the promises, kind is the word, dearer far than any message that ever heard. Pure was the mind of Christ, and this I see, he a great example is and pattern for me.
Good evening. Tonight, I would like to propose to you not exactly a question, but almost a theory. What if, during the construction of the Tower of Babylon, God never switched up the people's languages? In theory, they could have done the entire tower and in their mind, they would have completed their goal of going up. Tonight, I would like to talk about unity. The reason they were so successful up until that point is because they were in unity. What if the church had this level of unity? What if the church had this level of fellowship? Tonight, let's read Philippians 2, 2-4. If you would turn with me there at this time. Philippians 2, 2-4. And it reads, "Fulfill my joy by being like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through selfish ambition or conceit. In lowliness of mind, let each esteem others better than himself. For each of you look out not only for his own interest, but also for the interest of others." These verses tell us to be of one accord. They tell us to be together, to have the same love in mind with each other. I have 2 points I would like to share with you this evening, which will help us have a better unity with each other. The first being, we need to have humility with others. We are told this in Romans 12:16, which supports the evidence in verse 3. If you would turn with me there at this time. Romans 12:16. And it reads, "Be of the same mind toward one another. Do not set your mind on high things, but associate with the humble. Do not be wise on your own opinion." Which is telling us not to be prideful and to not think badly of others, but instead to lift them up and be of the same mind. If we are humble, we can unify much easier because of the harmony created. The second way we may have a better unity with each other is through love. In Ephesians 4:2-3, it supports the evidence found in verse 4 of Philippians 2. If you would turn with me there at this time, Ephesians 4:2-3. And it reads, "With all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace." We read in this passage, we are told to bear with each other in a loving manner so that we may keep the unity of the Spirit. So, what does this mean for all of us? It means that with unity, we can be one step closer to fulfilling God's commandments and to becoming more like Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God. If we strive to have the love and humility and love and patience and kindness of Christ, we have better unity with both Him and the church. Thank you very much.
Our next song is going to be 252. 252, "I Am a Poor Wayfaring Stranger." If you have it, let's sing. "I am a poor
in that right corner. I think us as Christians should see Jesus as an example. In Matthew chapter 5, 6, and 7, it's talking about the Sermon on the Mountain. Here we see how Jesus is preaching to the people. In Luke chapter 4, verses 16 through 19, it says how Jesus got up, opened a book, and started reading. Another example of when Jesus preached. I think Jesus is telling us that us as Christians should preach the word. In John 13, when Jesus is washing his disciples' feet, he's serving them. Other examples, Matthew chapter 8, Mark chapter 7, examples of when Jesus serves others. I think us as Christians not only should preach the word, but also serve others, and not only others, but we should serve God. In Mark chapter 8, verses 34 through 35, it talks about how Jesus was being crucified. And when I think about this, I think how Jesus was willing to die for God. And us being Christians, I think we should not only preach the word, not only serve others and God, but we should also be willing to give our lives for God. Thank you for your time.
Song number 694. To Canaan's land, I'm on my way.
To Canaan's land, I'm on my way.
Thomas. We can't think of his name without putting doubting in front of it or behind it. Doubting Thomas, he's earned his reputation because he quote-unquote doubted. This evening, I'm going to go over 6 points about the topic of doubt. To begin, what is doubt? The Webster's Dictionary defines it as to call into question the truth of, or be uncertain about something. Now, how does doubt work? Well, I believe to understand it, how it works, we first need to know where it begins. It begins when we think that God has failed to meet our expectations. To illustrate this, I'll use myself an example because I don't know many people here, and I don't know what people do for fun or sports and stuff like that. But I play tennis, and I hit shots that I know I'm capable of because I hit them all the time, right? You know, all day, every day. But then when I can't hit them, and I begin to doubt myself, can I actually do this shot? Though I know that I've hit these shots millions and millions of times. Thirdly, how does doubting affect our faith? You know, I see a lot of people doubt God and even doubt about his existence because of a tragic event that has happened in their lives, whether it be the death of an infant or a early death in a child. And more often than not, they'll say, where was God and why did he do this? What kind of God does this? And just like that, they lose everything. They lose their faith. Faith that took years and years, decades to build, is just gone. Like it was never there. Back to dust. Can doubting be healthy? Why, yes, it can. I believe it can. In fact, in Jesus' ministry, Jesus tells his disciples to doubt false teachers and to test them. And to a point, I believe that's what Thomas was trying to do. If we go back to Matthew chapter 7 and verse 21. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and be turning there. We'll be there for just a little amount of time. Matthew chapter 7 verse 21. And if you have your Bible that has the little subtitles on the top, mine says true and false disciples. I don't know what the others may say. It's in verse 21, it reads, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the ones who does the will of my Father who is in heaven. Many will say to me, Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name, and in your name drive out demons, and in your name perform many miracles? And then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Away from me, evildoers. That is the wrong verse. I'm so sorry. Are we allowed to doubt? And if so, should we be ashamed to doubt? Of course we can doubt. Yeah. But just not about God and God's existence, because many of us have been here for many years, and we know that that God is our God. And that our God lives. We shouldn't be ashamed of it, because even the disciples themselves, the people that walked with Jesus, the people that saw Jesus make many miracles, still had their doubts. And they were with him. They saw what he did. Notice how I didn't say just Thomas. I said the apostles, as in plural. And to finally wrap this up, how do we know the difference between a healthy doubt and one that isn't? To begin, I believe that the main key for this is to check our attitudes, to do a self-evaluation, if you will. If it's a sincere doubt, one that we want to know, one that we can learn from it, then I believe that that's considered a healthy doubt for me. But if not, then I think we have a problem, and I think we should be able to fix that. Thank you.
Will you bow with me? Lord, our Heavenly Father, we thank you much for this wonderful day that you've blessed us with. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity to come up here and to preach your word and to tell the good news, Lord, and that we may spread your word, Lord. And at this time, we pray for all those who need help, Lord, or are sick at this time, Lord. We pray that you may help them and give them comfort. We thank you for the life that we live, Lord, and we pray that we may worship you in spirit and in truth. We thank you for all that you bless us with, Lord, and we pray that you may help us with the rest of this worship. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Church. Walking in sunlight, all of my journey, and over the mountains, through the deep veil, Jesus has said, I'll never forsake thee, promise divine that never can fail. Heavenly sunlight, it's heavenly sunlight, flooding my
I am rejoicing, singing his Number 125.
O Lord my God, when I am awesome wonder, consider all the world.
Good evening. If you would be making your way to your seats. If you would like to mark the song of invitation, it will be number 800-800. Having done so, if you would open your Bibles to Titus chapter 2. When we consider the grace of God, we certainly consider it to be an amazing thing. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. The grace of God certainly is amazing. It is the grace of God which saves us, Ephesians 2 verse 8. Without God's grace, we could never have a hope of eternal life. In Titus chapter 2 and verse 11, we read, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men." God's grace has appeared to all. It is available to everyone through his word and his son. And it brings salvation. Through grace, it is possible that we can be saved from our sins. But the world is very confused about the subject of grace. And the problem with their confusion is that God's grace is one of the most important subjects to Christianity. Without the grace of God, we have no salvation. It is core. It is essential. And so we must understand grace. And the reason that they are confused is because, figuratively speaking, they will read Titus chapter 2 and stop at verse 11. They will read, "For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men," and stop. And then they will say that there are no requirements for grace, no restrictions, nothing that we must do. But that is not the case. If we continue reading in verse 12, "The grace of God has appeared to all men, teaching us that, denying ungodliness and worldly lusts, we should live soberly, righteously, and godly in the present age." The grace of God not only brings salvation, but in that bringing of salvation, it teaches us. In fact, that is how it brings us salvation. The grace of God teaches us, and that means there is something we need to learn from grace. And Paul tells us right here what we need to learn. We see three things. First of all, the grace of God teaches us to live soberly. In our culture today, the idea of being sober has taken on the meaning of being free from the use of alcohol or other mind-inhibiting substances. And the reason for that is because the word sober means to have a clear mind, to have a correct mind, to have proper and sound judgment. To live soberly is to live with the correct focus in life. Look to verse 13 of Titus 2. "Looking for the blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ." As Christians, the grace of God teaches us to look to God. God's grace teaches us to be focused in the way that we live. If we are recipients of the grace of God, then we should live in a way that focuses on the God of grace. Second, the grace of God teaches us to live righteously. Continue to verse 14, speaking about Jesus, "who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from every lawless deed and purify for himself his own special people." we notice two key words here, redeem and purify. Because of the grace of God, which we find in Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for us, we have been redeemed from our sins. We have been bought back by the blood of Jesus. And we have been purified. We have been made clean from our sin. When we consider that fact, certainly we see that the grace of God is amazing. But we also have to understand that there are conditions. If we are to be made clean from sin, what do we have to do? We have to stop sinning. We have to stop walking in sin and begin walking in the light, 1 John 1, verse 7. We must live in a way that reflects the grace of God. We must live righteously. And number three, we learn from the grace of God to live in a way that is godly. Godliness is simply God-likeness, living in a way that reflects the image and the character of God. At the end of verse 14, we have been purified to be God's own special people, zealous for good works. Because of God's grace, we are now called to be the people of God, his children, and because of that, we are called to be like him. We are called to obey him. We are called to work for him. If we are recipients of the grace of God, we must now live in a way that reflects the God of grace. The grace of God teaches us to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present age. But as we think about the reality of the Christian walk, that we are to be focused, living apart from sin, living in a way that is like God, certainly we understand that that is challenging. It is hard to live in a way that is focused. It is difficult to live separate from sin. It is certainly challenging to live in a way that reflects God. So how do we do it? And how do we get better at it? Paul has already given us the answer. It is the grace of God that teaches us how to live this way. If we find ourselves struggling to live soberly, righteously, and godly, then let us consider again the grace of God, how it has brought us salvation through Jesus Christ and his sacrifice for us. If you are here this evening and you are not yet a recipient of the grace of God, you haven't accepted the sacrifice that Jesus made for you on the cross, tonight you can receive God's grace. You can have your sins washed away, being purified to be God's people. This is possible through faith. Without faith, it is impossible to please God, Hebrews 11, 6. Because it is through faith that we come to obey God. It is our faith that will lead us to repent, to no longer trust ourselves, but trust God that his way is right, to confess Jesus to be the Son of God, and to be immersed in water for the remission of our sins, as Saul was commanded in Acts 22:16, arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. If you have not done so, the opportunity is afforded to you tonight to do so. Take advantage of this opportunity to become a child of God. And if you have done so, you have received the amazing grace of God, but you haven't been living with the right focus. You haven't been living righteously. You haven't been living the way you need to. If you need the prayers of the church to strengthen you and help you, then let us know your need, and we will pray with you and for you. If you have any need this evening, please come forward as we stand and sing.
Zion's call sweetly rings over land and sea.
Once again, good evening. It's good to see each and every one of you tonight. And those of you who are visitors, thank you for coming. You're an honored guest. We hope that you'll stick around and get a chance for, allow us a chance to get to know you. If you are a visitor, please grab a white index card that's in front of you in the pew in front of you and fill out the visitors portion of that. Fill out the members portion of that if you would. And please send it down to the end of the pew as the singing of our closing song, the young men will pick that up. I will update, I've got some prayer list updates and some news items, but there still might be some remaining bulletins each of the exits, so please grab that. What I will be listing tonight are just the updates on that. As far as our prayer list updates, Sandy Taylor, the aunt of Saria Mascara, is on life support in Jacksonville, Mississippi. So let's pray for the Taylor family and for Saria during this difficult time. Joyce Voss is now at home, but is still feeling very weak. We continue to pray for Joyce. Doris Wynn is in HEB Hospital, room 301, due to a blood clot in her leg. Continue to pray for Doris. And this was just a recent update given to me before class tonight. Michael Swims, he is the youth minister at the Central Church of Christ in McMinnville, Tennessee. This is where Ben Bailey, the son-in-law of the Wilcoxes, preaches. Once again, Michael Swims, please pray for their family. Michael Swims' two-year-old son was found in their pool. He is on life support and not expected to make it through this. Pray for the Swims family. It's S-W-I-M-S, Swims. News items. Brown Trail is hosting a Youth Day this coming Monday, the 29th. It is along with area congregations, but we are hosting it at 9:30 in the morning and going till 1 o'clock. Going to spare the details, but we're going to have at least a half a dozen other congregations coming over to be with us. I'm not organizing all the events. That's someone else's, I believe it's J.J. Hendricks from Northwest, but it promises to be a lot of fun for about 3 or 4 hours. So I encourage our youth and parents to bring your youth over here Monday morning at 9:30, and please bring $5 with you for lunch. And we're promised to have a great time. And that'll be July 29th. Next Wednesday night is our Bible class promotion preview. Let me repeat that. Next Wednesday night is our Bible class promotion preview. Now, it is the 31st, and it's a fifth Wednesday of the month, and normally we have our fifth Wednesday devotional. We're not doing that. We're going to have the Bible class promotion preview. So during the last 15 minutes of class, the students will visit their new class and meet their teachers. And they will begin attending their new classes on Sunday, August 4th. If you have any questions, I'm sure the Alexanders can fill you in on all that information. So, but yeah, that it's almost the end of the quarter, almost the end of the summer. I can't believe it, but that's what's happening. And our singing workshop is just around the corner. Andy Baker will be here. It will begin August 4th. And so for those of you who are song leaders or members, it's for everybody to come out. Everyone will benefit from Andy Baker's singing seminar. So please make plans to come. Our Sunday afternoon service will be at 2 p.m. on August 4th. August 2nd through the 4th is the singing seminar. But our Sunday afternoon service will be at 2 p.m. on August 4th. We will not have a 5 p.m. service on August 4th. And so there will not be a potluck. So go out and grab a bite to eat and come back for an uplifting period of worship. Check the information center for the meeting times and additional information. And if I've made that very confusing, again, go to the information center and it'll be all clear to you there. And one last thing tonight, if you did not get a chance, I encourage you to get a chance to come and meet the young men who led during our Bible hour. The young men that are at the Future Preachers Camp, they did an outstanding job, and they've got a couple more days of work ahead of them, of camp. And so I encourage you to come meet them. And also, they might make their way to the back, because this was a very spontaneous thing. Last year, we did a root beer float night with the young men. We didn't buy any root beer or ice cream, but what we do have is that we have plenty of sandwiches from last night, okay? And some of the workers that were there last night in the kitchen are like, John, what are you saying? We found 10 cases of sandwiches that should have been served at SYS last night. And so tonight we're going to have a sandwich social. And you're all welcome to the NPR, okay? Sound good? All right. Thank you.
Closing song will be number 291. Number 291.
I know not why God fortress makes to me.
Bow with me. Our most righteous Heavenly Father, we come before your throne knowing how much you love us, Father, and how much you care for us. We thank you, Lord, for, again, the safe travels here. We thank you for the time of encouragement we've spent with the family of God here. We thank you, Lord, for the refreshing times of studying your word and singing songs of praise and seeing young men who are be our future leaders, Father, who treated your word with great love and care and seriousness. We thank you, Father, for this great family here, this great congregation and its leadership. We pray continued strength for us and courage and as we go out to this world, Father, that needs to hear the saving message, Father, the message of grace. Lord, we bring before you, Lord, Sandy Taylor. Lift her up in prayer and her family during this difficult time as she's on life support, Father. We pray for comfort for this family and, Father, for comfort for the Swims family in Tennessee during these difficult, hard times of seeing loved ones, both old and young, who are whose life is on the line. And Lord, we just pour out our heart and lift up these families up to you, Father, that you will care for them and that the body of Christ there locally will surround them, swarm them with love and help them through these times. And Father, for Joyce Voss and for Doris Wynn, we pray for them, Lord, as they struggle or have had struggles with their health. And we pray, Father, for quick recovery for them and strength for them. Father, we thank you for our visitors. We thank you, Lord, for their desire to come and worship with us. We thank you for their safe travels likewise. Be with them as they depart from here. Father, we thank you always for the time of fellowship we have with one another. We pray, Lord, as we depart tonight that we will make our way home safely and so that we can go out and serve you by serving others around us. It's in Christ's name we pray all these things. Amen.